Now, you know, I did a free write for a group recently where I was following the adventures of a peasant who kept coming across Murphy's Law, where everything sucked. Adventurers were looting his fields, were looting his people. In fact, I might bring it into this series. I like that idea. Into this book. I like the idea of this peasant warrior. Whatever. So anyway, he basically becomes a dungeon master. Like, the further he goes into a cave, and the adventurers follow him there because there's rumors of tricks and of monsters and deadly traps. And really, it's just him trying to scare people away. And then, so they go into the cave. He goes further into the system, comes across warring gnomes and... Or warring dwarves and elves, dark elves and... Sylvan dwarves or whatever. No, it was gnomes. It was those gnomes. Whatever. Sylvaners. I don't know what the fuck they're called. Suffice it to say, right off the bat, we already have fantasy-based races, and we're a few interesting characters. I forgot. Oh, that's right. The monk beastkin. Let's make him a tiger. Tiger nigga. So you got the wandering beastkin, who I'm going to say he at first works for the bad guys, but then comes and helps them out every now and then. And there will also be a secret fire. So he'd be fire, I guess. Yeah, fire. Yeah, fire. Tiger. Fire. Yeah, he'd be the first. He'd be the one for that. And for the most part, we could have. Here's the subversion. We'll work on that later, probably with characters. Here's the most important thing that I was thinking about earlier. Why I want to make it suddenly a comedy. This starts after the defeat of the Devil King, but in his wicked throne of dark bone and obsidian. But what actually happens, even though the world, now where we're going to start the book off from, is that the hero has disappeared. The elven ambassador is locked up in the elf ambassador's place, palace at the kingdom, this main central kingdom. Let's not call it central, I've done that before. I don't know, let's call it the city of... What's that? Corolla? Corolla? No, that's like a Toyota. Fuck. Blue City. In Blue City, where all four elements meet, where the Mage's Tower is, where the Wizard's Library, the Scholarium is, that's where you will all, and of course the Colosseum, because I always have to have an arena of some sort. So, into the arena! So yeah. Gladiators, my nigga. No slavery, though. Maybe not slavery, but indentured servitude. Either way. So with that stated, just from the setting alone, I derailed. So, the Oracle ends up on the island where she lives, water. The Beastkin just disappears and wasn't even part of the group to begin with. But the fire, armored warrior that was coming with them was actually a guardsman, and that was just a plant by the king, who secretly was going to kill the hero anyway, Jack the Sword, and then claim the Devil King's kingdom. Why? Because, I don't know, this guy is... We'll work on that later. Characters. For now, all that matters is that the king wants to fuck everything over, claim everything, because that's what he does. And in all honesty, he is the villain. He is the monster. He is the bad guy. With that stated, what actually happens is that... Oh, and once again, the... That was it! The hero is a little farm boy peasant, because I love that starter. And actually, the earth companion was actually his dwarf cleric friend, his buddy, who and he's the one who actually joins the cult of the Holy Sword, realizes what's going on with the king, and then tells the after they defeat the Devil King, I'll get into that in a moment, after they defeat the Devil King, he's the one who points out to his crew, guys, we can't go back, he's gonna kill my friend, he's gonna fuck us all over, and he's gonna take over this whole world. We need a plan, and we need to do something now. I've conferred with my gods, and they all realize, they've come to the same conclusion individually, that they saw the little breadcrumbs of the trail of clues, except for the farm boy, who is incredibly naive, because that's where his power comes from, literally his faith in his friends and such. A faith in himself, once again, but he lacks self-confidence. So, they go into hiding. They literally burst into treats. They burst into bears! But maybe I should make the guy a bearkin. Maybe I should make him a bear guy instead. A martial artist bear! And he has the ability, his ultimate is that he summons 10 fucking bears. That's what he does! Bears! I like that idea. So, they get to the Devil King. They fight their way amongst the slimes and hordes and monsters of the underworld. After going through another dimension that is connected to this world, not the world of the dead, but okay, there's four different planes now. So a world of magic, a world of the primal world, a world of magic, a world of the dead, and a world of demons and such. Where honestly, they actually couldn't give a fuck, but they are locked in a perpetual cycle with this other world. They've never thought about destroying that shit because usually they're just trying to live their lives. And this is where we're going to go into the subversion. this is where we're going to get into that part that I love the most. This is where they go to face the Devil King, and while the hero pulls out the sword and it's glowing, and he's like doing his monologue about how he's going to defeat him, the Devil King just kind of slithers just in a very sultry and sensuous manner, because this nigga is sexy as hell, and he can change genders at will because I want it to be that way. I'm just saying, I could be your angle, or I can be your fuck toy. So he gets off the throne while the hero's doing his thing. He just kind of walks over calmly, takes the sword, kind of puts it under his armpit, lays on the ground, and goes, "Whoop! I've been defeated. You defeated me. Looks like you're the new Devil King." And the hero's like, "What?" I like that idea. So the Devil King gets up, hands him the sword back, and goes, "Go sit on the throne, do whatever you want with it. I don't care. I'm gonna go take a vacation. Fuck you. Fuck this noise. I don't want to fucking die right now. I'm not in the mood for this shit. I'm taking a vacation." And so he just leaves. In all actuality, so the heroes hang around for a bit, they destroy the throne, but then they come to find out that this particular Devil King, something was different about him. For one thing, he was born at the same time as the hero, a twist of fate that would connect these two. The hero has like zero confidence, and the Devil King has all of the confidence. He got that style-y, and for the most part, what we're gonna see here, what we're gonna see unfold, is that they're going to realize, and the reason, another reason why they found out something bad's going down with the king, they're going to realize that the negative plane, let's call it the negative plane, the negative dimension ain't that bad of a place right now, and it hasn't been for a long time. Yeah, sure, it's a swirling morass of chaos and dark clouds and thunderstorms everywhere and landmasses, except for the main one where the Devil King and the throne is. And they fucked up the throne! That's gonna be some fun later on. So, the throne and the Devil King on the throne is what keeps order in that particular mass. Like, they only have, like, one major city, you know what I mean? Unlike the physical plane, where everything is stable, the negative plane is not. And thusly do they actually balance one another. But the king has been trying to disrupt that shit for reasons in my head, and we'll go into that later on some other time. But, that right off the bat, right there. Boom! And that's the subversion. So they find out that this Devil King, ever since his birth and ever since he took over at an early age, has been instituting unions and good social programs for devils at work. So the kingdom is actually paying for childcare and such, and healthcare and education. This is actually sounding like a pretty good fucking place to me. So I'm just saying, you know, he cares for and as he points out later on in the book, we go from the bottom up. From the bottom up is how we determine the strength of the Devil Kingdom. The king, on the other hand, is vice versa. He's been from the top down for a while. I mean, there's the rich elite that are running things and ruling things and are just terrible. There's fucking up people. There's not slavery, but there is indentured servitude of the slavish kind. There are tons of people missing on the daily there, you know what I mean? But the people cry out, and there's nothing that they can really do except for belief in the heroes, belief in the cult. The cult of the sword, and later the other two, I guess we'll work on that later. The cult, which for the most part does their best to mitigate the damage and lay outside the control of the elites as well as the rulers. And that's only because the people flock to them. People believe in them as much as they do. The cult, well, does its best to not only not incite riots and not incite rumors of rebellion, but even work with the king, very publicly so, to destroy and squash any rebellions, you know what I mean? All for the sheer goal of keeping the people placated while the king does his thing, which is mostly ruling in a terrible, terrible fashion. So, we have a high dark fantasy comedy setting right now, right the fuck now, you know, a somewhat medieval level of technology, but backed perhaps by Magitek. I don't know, we'll go into that some other time. But for now, that's what's up. I don't have a title for this little thing right now, but high dark fantasy comedy. We've built this world. We have little quirky things going on. And who knows, I might take off that idea about the mana, you know, being used by only certain people, whatever. But I do like the idea of faith-based magic in something like this. And even more so that the hero and the Devil King were just born to fuck with everything. They were literally the rock that was thrown into the placid waters, and now we're going to start writing about not the fight itself. We can reveal that later on in the book, the next book, whatever. But rather, the ripples thereafter is where I'm going to focus this title on. So there we have it. You got the Devil King, you got the hero, you got the four companions, you got the setting, you got the genre, you got the world, you got all that fun shit. What are you doing? What have you done? You know, tell me in the comments below, what kind of setting and genre do you want to write this in? Or make this in? Or draw this in? Or whatever have you! Even music, shit. I do that for Anubis Unit, if you consider that. Or High Dark Heavy Metal Fantasy. Straight talk. So I'm just saying, there's a lot of good right off the bat right there. I hope this actually does help you, give you some insight in how I make my worlds and what I do. And, you know, at least with the settings. You know what I mean? We still have plenty more world building to come. And I think I might even jump the gun just a little bit. But it's okay. It's okay, man. That's what this is about. So, for the most part, what's your setting? What's your genre? I would love to hear from you about it. I am Thomas Duder, author of The Things. This is Haymakers and Hellhounds Season 0 World Building. I am Thomas Duder.